20% of my body, second, third degree burns at Milwaukee. Mm-hmm. I think that was the biggest, probably the hardest comeback I ever had to come back in racing, because most people's ever been burnt real, real bad. They never make a return. I mean, they might try it, but they haven't been successful. You've got some of them, Nicky Lotti, he come back. He's been very successful, you know, and won the world championship at that. But usually a person that's been burnt real bad, that is a fear that's really hard to get out and get away from, because I know after that, the first couple, two, three, every time I'd almost lose my car, I'd just almost go petrified, because I knew that every time you hit the wall, it was going to blow up.
1967, your third victory. Oh, how thrilling. Parnelli Jones and the Turban really had you beat till he dropped out right toward the end. Then coming for that checkered flag, all of a sudden in front of you, an accident erupts, and I can remember saying, where is he? Where is he? Where is he?
Yes, that was a day that I'll never forget. I knew that we chased the Turban hard all day long, but he just had so much more horsepower, you know, and the car was just so much advanced over us that all I knew we could do is just keep pressure on him. And we tried to do that all day long. We run hard, and I don't know why that last lap after, you know, we had the lead, I was going down the back straight, and if you recall, I was passing much cars, and I just backed off. And then all this happened in front of me like it was a story playback. And then I said, oh, no, I've won it, but I've lost it. And I was all at smoke, and I'll never forget, I dropped it back down in second gear, and I said, the starting line's not too far, so I kind of made a couple of zigs and zags, and I seen the smoke, and I says, well, if somebody's in front, maybe I can carry them past the starting line with me, so.
You know, 1973 was a terrible year. 3 days of rain, Pollard was killed, Art Pollard was killed, Swede Savage killed race day, Salt Walter, fiery crash at the beginning of the race, and that was fire.
Yes, it was, you know, that was probably a horrible-looking sight for the spectators, yeah. Where Swede Savage hit the wall, and then he slid down the front straightaway on fire.
There were so many things that went wrong in 1973. There was also a crash on the first lap, the first day we tried to run the race.
Well, that's quite true. You know, that's where the accident with Salt Walters happened. And a lot of people, you know, at one time says, you know, I touched him. When you look back at the replay, I wasn't even close to him. To me, the way the accident looked, it looked like he just, Kevin Coogan that year, just broke the rear wheels loose with the turbo boost and just jumped sideways on him.
I must say, you seem to be able to take defeat more philosophically now than back then.
That's quite true, Tom. I do take it, but I don't like it deep down. But I figured I'm kind of on a plateau now. I've kind of leveled off a little bit. I know my days are numbered. I don't do the things that I used to do 20 years ago. I felt like I'm a little bit smarter. You know, 20 years ago, I didn't care. And I still get crazy every now and then, but I try to control myself.
Don't let your babies grow up to be cowboys.
AJ's fierce determination to excel, to master any situation that confronts him, is the mark of the man. For AJ, racing is winning, and finishing second is losing.
1 mile short of 10,000 miles, 1 mile short. You gotta wait till next year.
I'm not gonna worry about it.
Don't let your babies grow up to be cowboys.
What gives Slice that extra kick?
Juice!
We got the juice, we got the blast. We got the taste that no one has. We got the juice, we got the twist. We got what Spider 7-Up would miss.
10% fruit juices.
We got the juice, we got the burst. Slice, slice, we turn it loose to cool your thirst. So nice, we got the juice.
Diet too.
Slice, slice.
Fort Harrison Villa offers you more. Your own home in a quiet residential atmosphere. The luxury of your own private clubhouse. The service of a professional landscape team. Yes, Fort Harrison Villa truly offers you more.
Got his hands full clearing Gene Barry of murder.
He could be in big trouble.
Crazy like a buck. Then, did you just gurgle? Hawk and Santini are smack in the middle of a kidnapping conspiracy on Airwolf. And Magnum discovers a secret plot.
Guys, quickly!
Could Higgins have turned traitor?
This man is an intruder in the camp.
Then we'll have to shoot him.
Oh!
The action starts tonight.
Done in the pits, separate men working as one. The 1986 Indianapolis 500 Pit Stop Competition, tonight at 10:30 on TV10, the news station.
Who built AJ's first race car?
I built it.
And what kind was it?
It is a 39 Ford coupe stock car.
Have you encouraged A.J. to race through the years?
No, I just, first he was wanting to race, and then I figured, well, if he'd quit racing on the streets, I'd let him get on the tracks with it.
So you thought helping him and making his car safe was, of course, important.
That's right. We tried to make it as safe as it could be built.
Tony, what's some of your early remembrances of A.J.'s racing?
Well, before he got on the tracks to run, he took a midget out of the garage and running around in the backyard out there and until he hit the side of the house with it and set it on fire. And I was out of town at another midget race.
Did you tell him that he'd have to quit after that or they'd have to just shape up?
No, I didn't say too much because he wasn't nothing but around 8 or 9 years old then. And so I just talked to him and told him that was awful dangerous to fool with something like that.
A.J., you're quite a family man. You're very close to your dad, Tony, and of course you're very close to your three children and Lucy and your sister. But back to your dad, how have you been able to recover from his death?
Well, I think I have had to finally put it that he's gone. Mother and him both are gone. They're not going to be back. I said before I felt like I was too close to my family, but that's probably not the proper word to use. That's one reason I've tried to spin away from my kids a little bit. I haven't, but you know, they always call me. But I don't know, my father and I was in racing just like he taught me, going back in the 24-hour race. I haven't run one since Le Mans in 67. He was at the hospital, you know, dying. He knew it. Mr. France and him talked to me 2 or 3 times about coming down, you know, running the 24-hour race. And finally, one day he said, son, why don't you go down there and just get away from the hospital? I says, well, Daddy, I need to be. No, he said, just go on off the weekend and have you some fun. I said, okay. So I went down there and was fortunate enough to bring back the trophy, the winner of the 24-hour race. And like I said, if I never won another race in my career, I could never holler for the good Lord was fortunate enough where he talked me into going and was lucky enough to bring back the trophy and have it in his hospital room when he passed on.
The Hoosier 100, do you miss that? Do you miss sprint car competition?
I really do. To me, that is real racing on the dirt where you have a control slide and thing. I've come so close to coming back there running. But I think one of the biggest reasons right now, a lot of the drivers driving the championship cars on dirt, I'm not familiar with them. And what you'll wind up doing is getting yourself hurt because, you know I can run hard and run fast. But still, when you run the guys every day, you kind of know what moves they're going to make when you run up on the outside or inside.
A businessman. You are that. You have many varied interests, don't you?
Well, yes, I do. I've got some real estate interests and a little oil business and rent properties, and I got a dealership here, you know, and
Chevrolet dealership. Business,
Chevrolet dealership, yes. I've had it going on 16 years. It's my son's graduated from college now, and he's in the business with me. He come there earlier this year, so.
The University of Texas.
Right.
Let's go back 20 years. Riverside stock car.
That was really the first major accident I ever had in my life. That's where we had some self-adjustment brakes that Ford Motor Company come out with, and they didn't have no stops on them. And what happened is right at the end of the day, I was running second to Dan Gurney out there, which Dan Gurney, you know, more or less owned Riverside at that time. You just didn't hardly beat him. And I reached up to hit the brakes, and they just went to the floor, you know. And so that's when they had the deep hole there, which Ford, you know, filled in. It was probably 20, 30 foot deep. And I felt like maybe I could embed the car into the bank down there And just as I went to go off the racetrack, if you recall, there's some dips there, and it's very windy, and the car hit a hole and kind of jumped up, and then it took off through the air like an airplane. And I really felt like that was one time that I would be dead. I really did, because, you know, I went end over end, and I can remember, you know, passing out in the car, trying to hang on. It's kind of like one of them dreams. You're hanging on the side of a building, but your hands are slipping.
Was that accident what led you to purchase the ranch outside of Houston here?
It really did. I was always wanting a little farm, you know, a ranch. And I felt like, you know, that I was just going to go ahead and buy me a little farm out there.
You might have to earn a living as a farmer.
Right. That's not a bad life, I'll tell you what.
Yeah. You really enjoy the ranch, don't you?
I really do, yes, I really do.
You spend a lot of time there.
I do, yes.
What do you do there?
Well, you know, I bought it as all woody. I select cleared it. I built myself about four or five ponds. I just built another new home out there. There's about seven homes out there. You know, people work for me. Built me a 5/8 mile racetrack with a pond in the middle of it where I trained my race horses. I've got close to 1,500 acres out there. Got a lot of deer out there.
Cattle?
Cattle. Got about 350 head of mama cows.
You've always had cattle, haven't you?
Yes, I have. I've always enjoyed the cows. And then instead of using all the mowing machines and gasoline, we kind of rotate from pasture to pasture. Got about 125 or 30 head of horses. You know, a lot of them are race horses, but I got about, 25 or 30 brood mares. Well, you know, really, I got to look at it. Indianapolis is the reason I have this place out here. It's done a lot for me, racing has. I love racing, and I guess it's in my blood, you know. I love it out here. When I have a bad day in Indianapolis, a lot of times, you know, I'll come here and work, and I got real good people who help me. Building the lakes I did myself. We used to build all the fences. Now I've got some good boys that I call in that can do the fences, but the original fences and painted the fences about 3 years ago, I painted all these white fences. I painted almost all of them myself.
Well, you get a great personal enjoyment out of that.
I really do. I mean, I work like a dog, and everybody says they don't even like to come out to see me, because if I get somebody that comes out to see me, like George Snyder one time, for about 3/4 mile across here, I made George help dig the water line.
Now, your home sitting in the back over there, I know that you did so much of the work on that home, and I know this has to be a dream come true for you.
It really is. That area over there, you know, I built that lake in memory of my mother. Before she passed away, I made an island out there where she could drive her motor home and fish. She loved the ranch. She just idolized this place. After I lost my mom and then lost my daddy, I really lost interest in the place out here. I was just ready to give up and give away, because my father did so much of the work out here with me. He loved it. He wired all my buildings and all that, which saved me thousands of dollars. And he really, he'd worked just as hard out here as I would, and he really enjoyed it. And I'll never forget the one in the back. I turned around and he kept being some deer. So he said, when deer season's open, I'm going to shoot him. He brought his rifle out here. And deer season opened, that deer would come up every morning. I said, you gonna shoot him? No, he said he's a friend of mine. So he wouldn't shoot the deer. And then I built this home kind of, you know, for mom and dad, even though they're not here. They always talking about it. And I just put a lot of their things and a lot of their trophies, and that's the reason you see the home like it is.
Well, it's amazing. It's just beautiful and stuff full of closets. And
yeah, I've always liked closets.
The Foyt Ranch, 30 miles northwest of Houston, is a picture-perfect example of modern farming. The immaculate outbuildings, all a brilliant AJ orange, are connected by freshly paved roads. Miles of sparkling white fence separate the green pastures. The setting is perfect for the beautiful new home, and it all makes a strong statement about the man who owns it. A man who makes great demands of himself and always reaches for the best life has to offer.
Some people will go to a lot of trouble to stay cool. But why go to all that trouble when it's so easy to call Supreme? The folks at Supreme can show you how a Bryant high-efficiency central air conditioner will keep you cool for less during the hot, sticky months ahead. In fact, we're so sure Bryant's high-efficiency air conditioning won't cost that much to use that Supreme will pay all of your highest month's electric bill this summer after installation. Bryant and Supreme, the simple way to keep cool this summer.
It's springtime, it's May time, and it's race time. It's also time to see Sycamore Chevrolet Nissan for a new car, whether it's a luxurious Corvette or the new economical four-passenger Sprint with a sticker of only 5670 and a mileage rating of 55 city and 60 highway. Over 500 new cars and trucks in stock, including 1987 Nissans and crew cab duallys. Big selection of all Chevy and Nissan cars and trucks at Sycamore Chevrolet Nissan, just south of the Honey Creek Shopping Mall on Highway 41 in Terre Haute.
When I first got this car, she only had 10,000 miles on her. Now she's got over 100. Because I haven't found one I like better. My chew? That's different. Like a lot of folks, I used to chew Levi. But this Granger Select's got less stems, so I get a cleaner chew. Made of premium leaf, so I get lots of flavor. And I better, because if it doesn't have it here, it doesn't go here.
Meet up with Granger Select. It could change your chew.
If you're one of those people who craves excitement, agonizes over a decision,
just a second, Laura's going to change her mind again,
quivers with anticipation, and can't believe it when you've guessed the right price, then the Nighttime Price is Right is your kind of show.
The Price is Right, Sunday night at 11:30 on TV 10, the news station.
On May 25th, A.J. will be driving in his 29th consecutive 500-mile race. A longevity record that may never be equaled. Adding greater numbers to the many records he holds at the track is not his main objective, however. His goal is the same one that brought him to Indianapolis way back in 1958. What are your plans for the championship trail this year?
I don't know yet, to be honest with you. We're going to play it by ear. My main goal is run good at Indy and try to win. That's mainly what we're aiming for at the present time.
Why did you buy 5 new marches?
Well, we feel we might need them, you know, right now. We've got 3 of them, 2 of them's in, but and then probably we won't pick up the other 2 till later on. But you never know. You know, these cars today is not like the old race cars, and you wreck when they're junk. So it's better to have some insurance if you're going to race.
Here in the mid-1980s, do you think racing is really pricing itself out of business?
I would say so, Tom. Racing has got really, really on the uphill swing, and I don't know how long it can go like this. I mean, with any kind of team there at all, today it costs you over $1 million, and I can remember when I first went back there, we had like a $20,000 budget, Big Noddy and I, and, you know, we built a whole brand new car, bought a new off-engine, an A.J. Watson chassis, and you go there and race, but today you just put some zeros there and you got a chassis without a motor.
AJ, as you look back on your career at Indianapolis and look to the future, who are some of the drivers who are you respect for their great driving ability?
Well, really, through the years, Tom, I've been fortunate enough, you know, I've been there a day or two, about like you have, but all joking aside, you've had so many great, great drivers there and so many great, great people that it would be hard to single just one of them out and not include them all.
From dirt track racing in the 50s to the high technology of today's super speedways, AJ has always been a man in tune with the times.
Cardinal Telecable in Paris and Cable Brazil are your satellite specialists, established experts in satellite technology who will help you mix and match a complete system to meet your budget. Rent to own for as low as $24.95 per month. Complete system starting at $799. Financing is available, and your system is backed by a fully trained service department. Descrambling units also in stock. Call your satellite specialist, Cardinal Telecable in Paris and Cable Brazil in Brazil, and see why service separates us from the rest.
I've just entered the Pizza Inn Family Fun Sweepstakes. Jules can't enter. He's a puppet. The grand prize. Are you ready? A Pontiac 6000 STE and a sporty Pontiac Fiero and a Pizza Inn go-kart and a trip for 4 to any car race in the world, plus thousands of other great prizes. Enter today at Pizza Inn. Great pizza, great prizes. Any car race in the world? Okay, Jules, if I win, you can come too, but you have to go in the suitcase. You do.
Years of the Indianapolis 500.
Sports Locker Extra, The Foyt Legacy. Sponsored by Michelob Dry and Pepsi and Diet Pepsi.
Well, bless my soul, but what's wrong with me? I'm itching like a man on a fuzzy tree. My friends say I'm acting wild as a bug. I'm in love. I'm all shook up. Ooh, ooh, ooh. Yeah, yeah, yeah.
He is to auto racing what Elvis Presley is to rock and roll. To put it quite simply, Anthony Joseph Foyt Jr. is the king. Good evening, I'm Fred Khalil, and we don't have time in this program to list all the records and victories accomplished by the man from Houston, Texas, during his racing career that has spanned over five decades. Here at the Speedway Museum, they're paying tribute to A.J. Foyt, the first four-time winner here at Indianapolis. You can see his 1977 ride all the way back to the first one in 1961. And it's back in those early days at Indianapolis where we begin this program.
The year is 1958. An ill-fated start claims the life of racing great Pat O'Connor. It's also the day that A.J. Foyt made his first start at the Brickyard, finishing 16th. The month didn't exactly get off to a smooth start for the 23-year-old rookie driver.
I was just another guy in 1958. Well, I think the ironic thing happened, Robin. I go up there, and I can't remember who it was with USAC at that time to sign in. And Clint Bronner hadn't got to the Speedway yet with the car, and I went to sign in, and they said, well, who are you driving for? I said, well, Dean Van Lyne. And they said, well, the car's not here, and said, you got to come back whenever it's here. And I said, well, it's going to be here. He said, have you got a contract? I said, no, sir. But that's the car I'm driving. He says, well, we'll see you when the car gets here. So actually, Clint was like two or three days late, and I had just walked around the garage here. I couldn't even go in the garages. Then when the car got there, I got signed in.
And he's been here to race every year since. The thriving metropolis of Houston, Texas is A.J.'s hometown. His race shop on the far north side hasn't changed much over the years, but inside you'll find an ever-growing collection of racing memorabilia symbolizing Foyt's amazing longevity. It was his impressive ability in driving the midgets and sprints on the dirt tracks that earned A.J. his shot to drive for Clint Bronner and Al Dean at the big track.
The reason they picked me, and, you know, I had a big pair of shoes to fill, which I knew that I really couldn't fill them because Jimmy Bryan won the championship three times or whatever it was. I ran a real good race at Salem, Indiana on the high banks. And at that time, if you could run the banks, they felt like you could run the Indianapolis Motor Speedway. And I ran super. I won the race with the IMCA car the first time I ever went to the high banks. And I would have to say Clint Bronner was actually the one that saw me run and went to Dean Van Lines, and Al Dean's the one that hired me.
In this 1976 interview, the late Clint Bronner recalls the making of the legend.
The reason I picked A.J., that I heard about him, how he runs Salem and everything, and he was just a bull, and he happened through the garage area that late in that summer of 57, and he said he happened to come by the garage, and we was talking there, and he said he'd like to sit in a dirt car, so I says, go ahead. Well, he looked just about like Brian sitting there, so when I lost Brian that year, well, I told Mr. Dean about him, and we hired him as a rookie, and he showed great talent then, and I got to know him more about what he had been doing, and that I figured he'd really be a comer.
First time I met A.J. Foyt was in Fresno, California. I don't remember what year it was.
Former Indy driver Johnny Boyd drove roadsters with Foyt in the 50s and 60s.
First time I met him was at Fred DeOrio's garage, and I think he came out there for a stock car race, and this kid come walking up, and he said, I'm A.J. Foyt. And he said, someday I'm going to be the world's greatest race driver.
He said that to you?
No, he just said it to general, just in generalities to the guy sitting around there. And you know, like race drivers that are already established. Well, it was negative to most guys. But, you know, it was just the way he said it, Robin, that I looked at Fred and I said, you know something? I said, I've heard a lot of kids come up and say, I'm going to be the world's greatest race driver. And I said, most of them, I said, I'll see it when you do it. But just the way he said it, it wasn't being a braggart, it was a statement.
Not long after that statement, there would be no name in motorsport known to more people than that of A.J. Foyt.
You got the right one, baby. You know, I just love this new Diet Pepsi song, but do you think it's caught on yet?
You got the right one, baby.
You got the right one, baby.
the right one, baby.
With 100% NutraSweet.
When I shop for my family, they don't say much about the brands I choose, except for Mike Sells potato chips. They say it has to be Mike Sells, because they really do taste better. That's because they're prepared in 100% premium peanut oil, which makes them so naturally delicious.
When it comes to potato chips, everyone in the family loves Mike Sells. And whether it's old-fashioned, groovy, or original, they all agree, Mike Sells, they are delicious.
There are those who thirst for something different, something beyond the ordinary. For them, there is a beer that refreshes like no other. Michelob Dry. Once you've experienced its bold taste, with no aftertaste, there's no going back.
With the Oldsmobile Toronado's advanced engine and suspension, some look at it solely as a driver's car. And with a tastefully refined interior like this, some look at Toronado solely as a personal luxury car. But they all agree with Toronado's uncommon design. They just like to look at it, period.
I think the one big thing that they used to pull at Indianapolis Motor Speedway on the rookies were drivers take your helmets down to Magnaflux and have them Magnaflux. And I think that was one of the deals, and I fell for it, and right today, probably said, pull it again, everybody's good. And you'd see a lot of the rookies, they'd be taking their helmets down to get their helmets Magnaflux. And I tell you, and then everybody's down there laughing at you. But you know, you're a rookie and you're nervous. And I'll never forget, I carried my helmet down and they just broke up laughing.
Not long after AJ's initiation at the 500, he would be having the last lap. This fearless competitor going wheel-to-wheel with many of his racing idols. Victory coming in only his fourth Indianapolis appearance in a memorable duel with Eddie Sachs. His second triumph in 64 was the last victory for a roadster at Indy. Foyt was very reluctant to take part in the rear-engine revolution that swept the speedway in the 60s.
I would say a roadster was twice as hard to drive as a car today, because if you made a little mistake there in that roadster, you paid for it right then. You can make a lot of mistakes in the cars today, and they're forgiven. But a roadster, you wasn't allowed to make no mistakes. If you made a little one and saved it, you felt very lucky. You can make a little one in these other cars and save it, you know. But the biggest thing, you had to drive a roadster. These cars you follow. If you got it set up, all you do, you're sitting there. You don't drive it near as hard as you did a roadster. Because a roadster, you had to make it do things. And if these cars aren't handling the ground effects and the wings aren't adjusted, you can't make them do it.
Another striking difference between today's cars and the roadsters is the cost. In 1961, this roadster, the one that AJ won the race with, $25,000 complete, the front engine, the whole ball of wax. In contrast, today's 1991 Lola, sitting in Foyt's shop down in Houston, $325,000. And that doesn't include the engine. Foyt, clearly the dominant figure on the racing scene, adding the 24 hours of Le Mans, the Daytona 500, and seven national driving championships to his list of achievements. His third Indy victory in 1967 came against the powerful turbine engine of Parnelli Jones, which broke down a few laps from the finish. By this time, Foyt was a hands-on driver, car owner, and mechanic.
You know, I've never made any concessions about Foyt being a better race driver than me, basically. But the dedication that he had is what made him what he is, I'll tell you. And that's what it takes.
Many of the most satisfying triumphs for Foyt came on some of the most treacherous race courses, like Trenton and Langhorne.
That was a track you had to be in real good physical shape in, and you had to have your car working real good, and like you say, you had to be smart, and actually a little bit brave, probably add a little crazy to it. But no, really, you had to be in good shape and strong and just watch your P's and Q's, because I think what happened a lot of times over there, what they used to call pew collar, was it would get so rough, and you know, that's where we had power steering and all that stuff, that you'd start getting weak and you'd hit a hole and jerk the steering wheel out of your hand and let it flop the wheels. And that's the reason I'd say a lot of guys would get upside down. It was a demanding track. You had to stay on top of your car every lap. You was never allowed to breathe one moment. I mean, you was just had to stay on top of it.
Foyt feels very few of today's Indy drivers are cut out for that form of racing. In fact, looking back, he sometimes wonders how he ever survived.
The first year I qualified at Indy, I had a Dean Van Lance t-shirt on. You wouldn't think of getting in a race car and going out in practice, not qualify. I was so proud to make that race, and all I had was a T-shirt, one of the Dean Van Lines with the championships that they won.
In 1965, Foyt took his dirt champ car and put it on the pole at the Milwaukee race that year in August. He gave the rear engine cars all they could handle, finishing second.
I think one of the highlights of the deal was I already sent the starter back to Indianapolis and all the stuff, and Gordon Van Loo, Bobby Unser drove for, took his dirt car over, and I had to go borrow the starter from Gordon Van Loo and things like that. And after I sit on the pole, he said, "You done cost me $100,000 worth of these rear engine cars, and you done set racing back 50 years. I'll never forget the quote that he made. I mean, he was really hollering. He said, "The best car I got sitting on the trailer out there."
But of all of his racing thrills, none to A.J. compare with winning Indianapolis for the fourth time in 1977. A most vivid memory is taking his victory lap with Speedway boss Tony Holman, who passed away later that year.
I know he was pulling for me awful hard 2 years prior to that. We were so close. We ran a second and run a third. The rain cost us a race of 1 year. I was so glad because I think it thrilled him that he lived to see somebody win it four times. We've been friends for many years, and you know, I'm not family, but I feel part of the family, and I've never used them. They've never used me. We're just real good friends, and we talk. We have dinner. I went on vacation with them. We spent many a Christmases together. Mary and them used to fly down here in Houston, have Christmas down here. So we've just been real close to each other, and I respect them. I think they respect me, and it's never been a deal where I need two more tickets and go up and beg I need two tickets, because if I needed two tickets, I'd go buy them somewhere else.
Yeah.
And we've never used each other. And like I say, it's been more of a friendship than anything.
Was that?
Traffic's been crazy around here. Something about chicken.
Great. Crispy, juicy, delicious.
Hardee's fried chicken tastes preferred 63 to 37 over Kentucky Fried Chicken original recipe.
Sorry about that, it's the truth.
I don't like Kentucky.
Never ever buy Kentucky.
Hardee's chicken is ripping.
It's the best chicken I have ever eaten.
This is the place to stop, Hardee.
Now get 8 pieces of chicken, 4 made from scratch biscuits, coleslaw, and mashed potatoes with gravy for just $6.99.
Definitely.
Absolutely.
Your man from Train announces an offer worth not waiting for. Don't wait another minute for the comfort of a Train air conditioning system. For a limited time, he'll give you a check for $250 instantly, on the spot, no waiting.
Remember, gas is your best energy value. So call Aaron York's Quality Air Conditioning and Heating in Indianapolis or Rex Byers Heating and Cooling in Kokomo for your instant check now.
So what are you waiting for?
We wanted to change our life, so we took action.
We took Pontiac action during green light excitement time at your Pontiac dealer.
Pontiac action? We leased a new Grand Am LE Coupe for just $199 a month with a GMAC Smart Lease.
Or you can buy a new Grand Am and get $1,000 cash back.
Change your life. Take action. Take
Pontiac action.
Take Pontiac action during green light excitement time at your Central Indiana Pontiac Pack dealers.
While you still can.
Well, he showed some sports and some baseball and football and that, but auto racing was his biggest deal. In other words, automobiles. He just loved the automobiles and stayed with them.
Perhaps the most influential man in A.J. Foyt's life is Anthony Joseph Foyt Sr. Like father, like son, it was the old man that gave the kid his first taste of racing. It was a struggle for Foyt to come to terms with the passing of both his parents in the early 80s. It caused him to step back from the sport he loved and focus more on his business interests. The decade of the 80s shows Foyt with just one Champ Car win. There were injuries and frustration. Meanwhile, Al Unser Sr. joined Foyt in the four-time Winners Club at Indy.
I just let things slide by, and that's one reason I was wanting to go to all the races last year and really start working again at racing, you know, and to get back in the groove and get caught up, because it's my own fault that I got behind like I did. It was nobody's fault, my own.
Despite splitting his time between IndyCars and stocks and not doing extensive testing, Foyt still showed signs of competitiveness with top 10 finishes in 1989 and 90. Little did he know after his 33rd straight Speedway appearance, he was about to enter into his most difficult battle of all.
This is actually the car that I got out of.
See, here's the throttle. That all this is out to here, see?
Yeah.
When it went in, and they cut it here, spread it apart, because it all was wadded up on my feet.
Unfortunately for A.J. Foyt, his feet and ankles didn't fare much better when his brake pedal failed in a race at Elkhart Lake, Wisconsin, late in the 1990 season. It meant a long stay at Methodist Hospital, where Dr. Terry Trammell pieced his shattered lower extremities back together. The medical staff could only hope the legendary driver would be walking again in 6 to 8 months, let alone driving a race car. Rather than give in to suggestions that he should retire, Foyt renewed his desire to be a racer.
I look at the position I'm in right now, yeah, I'm in pain, I'm suffering, I'm hurting, it's going to be a long, hard road. But then, you know, there's other people right down that hall that's a hell of a lot worse than me, so I consider myself lucky to be as fortunate as I am right now.
By January, A.J. Foyt walks again.
When we planned A.J.'s goals, we built it around margin of error. We talked about that, that there's a lot of margin of error when he first gets back up on his feet and just walks. There's margin of error when he's out there playing with his boy. There's a small margin of error when he gets on his bulldozer, and maybe not as much when he's out there walking his horses. And there's a lot less when he gets back into that race car, and a whole hell of a lot less when he's trying to win Indianapolis.
Yeah. And still, I've got a long, hard road to go, but like this morning, I had to tell you, I walked all around the house on the carpet without nothing.
In the race to return, Foyt uncharacteristically let someone else call the shots. He turned to the Houston Oilers and their strength and rehabilitation coach, Steve Watterson.
I'm still not saying that everything will be fine by the time the race comes around, because there are too many other things that can happen. I will say this, that on time frame-wise, he is way ahead of schedule.
Watterson's direction, coupled with the Foyt determination, brought almost immediate results. This grueling five-hour ritual repeated daily, bright and early, 6:30 a.m.
And I'll be truthful with you, it's been a long, hard road. I know other people's had things like this. I wasn't planning on having this at this late stage in the game, but I feel like if I was not in a race, or I still would have to go through it, because I don't want to be a dead cripple the rest of my life. A lot of people come to me and say, why try to go back racing? Just why don't you say, it's over with? I'm going to go through this rehab if I drive a race car or not, because like I said, I don't want to go through the rest of my life being a cripple.
AJ's long, hard road brings him back to a race car for the first time, testing at Indianapolis in April.
Enjoyable, just out here back in the groove again and just shaking down a little bit and checking a new car out. Not looking for no fantastic speed, just trying to get comfortable again and get my feet working.
With his sights fully set on his Indy finale, there's still one important hurdle for Super Tex. But his full return to competitive racing in the Phoenix Desert late in April would not happen, as advised by his doctor.
I don't have the movement or feeling like I should have. I'd have to jam the brakes on or something real quick, and they just didn't want me to take a chance for Indy, you know, getting hurt here.
Still, there's precious information to be gained by running his new Lola on the mile oval, so enter another four-time champion, Al Unser Sr.
You know, if he probably had to, he could probably run here, you know, but he elected not to because of Indianapolis, but the guy's done a tremendous job on getting himself fit and in shape so he can run Indianapolis.
It's all a strong statement about a man who still demands the best from himself. Time now to reach back for one final fling.
Well, he wants to do it again. And, you know, whether other people think he should or whether they think he shouldn't, I guess comes down to the point to where that's what he wants to do. And it's going to be difficult for him. It's going to be hard on him because he's really been hurt a lot worse than a lot of people know.
There are those who thirst for something different, something beyond the ordinary. For them, there is a beer that refreshes like no other. Michelob Dry. Once you've experienced its bold taste with no aftertaste, there's no going back.
With the Oldsmobile Toronado's advanced engine and suspension, some look at it solely as a driver's car. And with a tastefully refined interior like this, some look at Toronado solely as a personal luxury car. But they all agree with Toronado's uncommon design. They just like to look at it. Period.
You got the right one, baby. You know, I just love this new Diet Pepsi song, but do you think it's caught on yet? Got the right one, baby.
With 100% new this week.
All glasses change how you see. No one can change how you're seen like Dr. Tavel. You can be a good sport or take care of business, have a night on the town, hit the books hard, or find your place in the sun. Many looks for every mood from the area's largest frame selection. Buy a pair now, get a second pair for $1. Two pairs of glasses in about an hour from Dr. Tavel. 1 hour glasses without the 1 hour price.
On May 26th, A.J. Foyt intends to be driving in his 34th consecutive 500-mile race here at Indianapolis. Perhaps more impressive than that feat is the kind of support he's received from his wife, Lucy.
She tried to talk to me in 1961. And about retiring after I won Indy. Yeah, I won the championship, remember, in 60 and then won Indy. She said, there's not much more that you can win, which she was right. And I said, well, look, I love you and I love the kids. I was racing before I met you. I don't really want a divorce, but I'm not going to give up my livelihood just to stay home at this young age. And she says, well, we need to think about it. I said, well, that's no thinking. I'm not going to quit automobile racing. To this day, my wife's never asked me to quit.
Part of what's made it all worthwhile for AJ is to witness firsthand the evolution of his sport. From a time where a driver was the mechanic, a builder, and an owner, to a time where an aerodynamicist and tire engineers came on board.
If somebody told me in 1958 that you'd be running around Indianapolis Motor Speedway without lifting and 200 miles an hour wouldn't make the race, you'd look at him, have you lost your mind? They'd take him to a nut house. Sure. And now that's just kind of warm-up speed. I hate to say that, but that's true.
Now, if you go out and run really well at Indy this year, are you really going to quit?
Well, yeah, we already made my decision that we was going to run through 91 and retire after the 91 season. Like I said, I wasn't expecting this year to happen, but then I told U.S. Tobacco, Mr. Bannell, I said, you know, if I have a good year, I might have to reconsider. No, you wouldn't be in the shape you are now if you'd listened to me 2 years ago.
It's hard to imagine the Speedway without AJ. He intends to be back as a car owner with a hand-picked driver after the 91 race. And looking to the future, he sees no easy solution for slowing these cars down.
There was no reason for this accident to happen that I had. I mean, you're going to break things, but then we come back with my other car that ran two 500-mile races. You don't use a brake. Jack Stone has worked for me 25 years, pushed sideways and the brake pedal pushed off. I mean, so we fixed it before we sent to Laguna. Well, nobody ever had this problem, they said. Why we had it, I can't tell you. But I wish that some of this stuff that they engineer and come up with, that they want to break away, you don't need it to break away, you know, because if you're going to hit that hard, it's going to be there anyway. So right now, to slow the cars down, people talk about flat bottoms. Flat bottoms, they've got them running just as fast as they used to have the tunnel cars. So the only thing, if a person is going to change everything, best thing to do is say there'd be no ground effects, no wings whatsoever, and build it into the bodies.
The fast speeds, the record number of appearances, is not what brings A.J. Foyt back to Indy for one last ride. His goal is the same that brought him here way back in 1958.
My life goal was just to win it once, and then be fortunate enough to win it, you know, four times. It's just hard for me to believe. A lot of people say, after I retire, what do you want people to think of you? And I said, really, you know, after I retire, I don't know. I said, my name's AJ, and I'm still going to be AJ, and I'm not going to change.
Burger Extra, the Foyt Legacy, has been sponsored by Pepsi and Diet Pepsi, and by Michelob Dry.